this is based on the 20 items of knowledge that Lord Krishna talks about in the 13th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. So Lord Krishna says there are 20 items of knowledge, and a person who is truly knowledgeable has these 20 qualities. So it's very important for us to know these 20 qualities and try to act accordingly. So we thought we will, every Tuesday for half an hour in the evening, we will discuss one by one the 20 qualities, 20 characteristics of knowledge as described in the 13th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita by Lord Krishna. So we are calling this as Knowledge Aikosagan series. So the first item of knowledge that Lord Krishna talks about is Amanitvam, which means humility. Amanitvam, humility. So today we are talking about humility. So we'd like to dedicate this session to His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, our beloved spiritual master. So what is humility? So many times we have this understanding. Humility means, generally we say, right? That person is very humble, we say, right? Just by looking at a person's external behavior, we tend to say that that person is very humble. But what is the actual definition of humility? So here in the purport, 13th chapter, Prabhupada says, humility means that one should not be anxious to have the satisfaction of being honored by others. That means we should not seek respect from others. That is real humility, right? Sometimes externally we may behave, someone may behave, very submissively, he may, very humbly, make a external show of humility, but within his heart, if he's having the desire to get attention of others, respect from others, if he is expecting these things, then that person is not truly humble. So humility means not being anxious for having the satisfaction of getting respect, receiving respect, honor, adoration from others. That is real humility. Next. Now let us see some case study. Can we go to the next slide, please? So we will see some case studies about what happens when we are not humble, right? We will see some case studies from the scriptures, from the Bhagavatam. We shall see two case studies about what happened to people when they were not humble. The first example or the case study is that of King Indra. We all know Indra is a very powerful devata, and he is the king of the heavens, king of all the devatas. So once it so happened that a sage brought prasadam garland to Indra and gave him, as you can see here in the picture. It's a prasadam garland. We all know when we receive prasadam garland, means garland which is offered to the Lord. We are supposed to honor it, respect it. But Indra, when he was given this garland, he was riding on his Airavata elephant, and he just threw the garland towards the elephant, and the elephant with its tusk just threw it apart. Tore the garland into pieces and threw it apart. And this was seen by the sage, and the sage became very angry at this. Actually, the sage became angry because Indra is performing, being in such a respectable position, he doesn't know how to honor devotional paraphernalia. He doesn't know how to honor prasadam. So he became angry and he immediately cursed him to become bereft of all opulences. So Indra lost all his opulences and wealth and riches. And because of the curse of that sage, Indra lost his bodily luster. He lost all his powers. Now, this incident is mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam and in many other scriptures. Now, to highlight the fact that even if somebody is in such a position as the king of the heaven, Indra, if he is not humble, if he is too puffed up by his position, then he will actually fall down from his position. So this is one case study. Another case study, let us see, that is the case study of Daksha Prajapati. We all know about this interesting incident. Daksha Prajapati, when he happened to actually visit a sacrifice which was conducted in the heavenly planets, there all the administrative devatas and various personalities, important personalities from the universe, they had all come there. And Daksha Prajapati entered the arena of the sacrifice, and everybody stood up in respect. All the devatas stood up in respect, and other personalities, sages, everybody stood up in respect, except for Lord Shiva. So Lord Shiva did not stand up, because Lord Shiva is not an ordinary personality. So he is Mahadeva, and he is respectable by everybody. But still, Daksha Prajapati thought that this Shiva is actually my son-in-law, and he must have stood up and he must have given me respect. That means he was expecting respect from others. You can see here, Daksha Prajapati, and we know the consequence of this, what happened later. Daksha Prajapati lost his life, and then when he was pardoned by Lord Shiva, he was given life and he was given a goat's head. Of course, that is a story. But the gist that I want everyone's attention here is, Daksha Prajapati, being in such a respectable position, he did not practice humility. And because of which he had to face a lot of difficulties to such an extent that he lost his life. Right? Now, another case study that I came across, this is an interesting thing in the modern day. Very recently this has happened, or this is being happening. iPhone X. Apple fans smash new phone just moments after buying it. Why this is happening? Because generally people think, at least in India, having an iPhone is supposed to be a status symbol, and people want to flaunt their iPhones. So as soon as they buy or they have their iPhones, they flaunt it. They show it in front of everybody. And there are instances where the phone has slipped off from their hands and it has broken into pieces, both the front and the back. So that means when you try to be proud of your possessions, so what happens is you lose it. Now we see in all the three cases, Indra's case, Daksha Prajapati's case, and even this iPhone, in all the three cases we see that when you are not humble, when you are not grounded, when you become too proud of your possessions, you will end up losing them. Right? These are the three case studies. Let's go next. So the conclusion is, pride goes before a fall. This is a very famous saying. We all have heard this proverb. Pride goes before a fall. That means if you are proud, not humble, then you're surely going to fall down from wherever you are, from whatever position you are. So that's what we saw in the three case studies. Now let's try to understand the next part. What happens when we are humble? Hello? So humility, when we are humble, what is the benefit that we get? Let us see this through some case studies again. The first case study that I'm planning to show, talk about, is about a great devotee king called Ambarish Maharaj. The life and character of Ambarish Maharaj we will take questions at the end. Please listen, we'll have a discussion first. So this is the this life and character of Ambarish Maharaj is described in Srimad Bhagavatam, one of the Vedic scriptures. So Ambarish Maharaj, even though he was the emperor of the whole world, still he was a very detached personality. He was a great devotee of Lord Krishna. And once it so happened that he observed Ekadashi, and on the next day, on the Dwadashi day, when he wanted to break his fast, the sage Durvasa Muni came along with his different disciples, and he said, I would like to partake the Dwadashi Prasadam in your palace along with all my disciples. I'll just go have a quick bath and come back, because generally on the Dwadashi day, we are supposed to break the fast at after sunrise at a particular time. So Ambarish Maharaj said, okay, please go, come back. It will be my honor to have you as my guest. So Ambarish Maharaj was waiting for Durvasa Muni and his disciples to return back, but the time for breaking the fast was actually getting over. So because of that, he took permission from his from the Brahmanas, and he took some water. He drank some water. And Durvasa Muni came to know about this because of his mystic powers. And he came back enraged with anger. And he said, how dare you accepted me as your guest? And before feeding the guest, how can you actually break your fast? So Durvasa Muni became very angry. And with his mystic powers, he created a demon. You can see that a fiery demon was created just to kill this Ambarish Maharaj. But in spite of all this, the anger of Durvasa Muni and the fiery demon troubling him, Ambarish Maharaj did not actually utter a word. He was just folding his hands and praying to the Lord, meditating on the Lord. In fact, Ambarish Maharaj was so powerful, I mean, he was so great devotee, that the Lord had left Sudarshana Chakra with him for his protection. That means he was such a great devotee that the Lord himself had given his Sudarshana Chakra for his protection. But still Ambarish Maharaj did not flaunt his Sudarshana Chakra. Like we people flaunt our iPhones. Ambarish Maharaj did not flaunt. So he just kept silent. He just folded his hands and he just was praying to the Lord. He was not at all disturbed. So even though he was cursed, even though he was in such a difficult situation, Ambarish Maharaj practiced humility. He did not show off his power. And of course, later Sudarshana Chakra starts chasing Durvasa Muni. Durvasa Muni goes everywhere. He appeals for help with Brahma, Lord Shiva, Lord Vishnu himself. But all of them say, no, we cannot protect you. And finally, Lord Vishnu tells Durvasa Muni, go and ask forgiveness from Ambarish Maharaj. If Ambarish Maharaj forgives you, then only you will be saved. So finally, he had to come and ask forgiveness. So the point is, Ambarish Maharaj is an example for humility. So he did not show off his power. On the contrary, Durvasa Muni wanted to show off his greatness. He wanted to show off his mystic powers. And he was not humble. And that is why he ended up in trouble, whereas Ambarish Maharaj was protected by the Lord. Another case study, the next case study about humility. Can we see the next slide? Yes. A case study of... It is said that Daksha Prajapati had many sons, and Narad Muni wanted to actually deliver all these sons. I mean, wanted to show the path of real knowledge to all the sons of Daksha Prajapati. So Narad Muni goes and he shares the knowledge of spiritual science with all the sons of Daksha Prajapati, and all the sons of Daksha Prajapati become liberated personalities. They all take up spiritual life. And this enraged Daksha. He became very angry. I wanted my sons to become emperors and to have big number of expand the family lineage and all that. But Narad Muni invoked a spirit of renunciation in my sons, and this is not good. Daksha Prajapati became very angry and he cursed Narad Muni. What was his curse? Narad Muni was cursed that you may go anywhere, but you will not be able to stay in one place for a long period of time. This was the curse Daksha Prajapati gave to Narad Muni. And what was the response of Narad Muni? He did not counter curse. Narad Muni was very powerful. He could have counter cursed, but he just accepted the words of Daksha Prajapati. He just said, in fact, Daksha Prajapati cursed that you will not be able to stay in one place for a long time. So that curse was accepted very happily by Narad Muni, right? So Narad Muni said, in fact, it is a benediction for me. In fact, I can go to more and more places and share the knowledge of spiritual science with more and more people. So this is how he took it. So Narad Muni was humble enough to know that whatever happens is by the will of the Lord. And whatever situation comes, I should use it as in the service of the Lord. This was the mentality of Narad Muni. So Narad Muni did not waste his time becoming angry and cursing back Daksha Prajapati. Like, so here also we see the humility of Narad Muni. So from the case studies of Ambarish Maharaj and Narad Muni, we see that those who are humble, they actually make more progress. They don't get stuck with situations. They don't get stuck saying that, oh, he is my enemy, because of him I am suffering. No, they don't. They accept everything as Lord's blessing. And that is why Krishna says that humility is a sign of knowledge. One who is truly knowledgeable only can have this humility, amanitvam. Let us go to the next slide. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu actually gives us this advice. If we want to chant the holy name of the Lord always, then this is what we must practice. Trinadapi sunichena taroriva sahishnuna amanina manadena kirtaniya sadaharihi. It means one should chant the holy name of the Lord in a humble state of mind, thinking oneself lower than the straw in the street. One should be more tolerant than a tree, devoid of all sense of false prestige, and should be ready to offer all respects to others. In such a state of mind, one can chant the holy name of the Lord constantly. The very important point here is, amanina manadena. One should be ready to give respect to others, but one should not expect respect from others. In this state of mind only it is possible for us to always remember Krishna or chant his holy name. Now, this does not mean that sometimes humility is wrongly understood also. Sometimes we think, oh, let others do anything with me, so I should simply keep quiet. I should not say anything. No. It's not like that. For when it comes to your self-protection, yes, you have to take action. Doesn't mean that you allow others to play with your life or just play around like that. No. But when we saw the examples of, these two devotees, Ambarish Maharaj and Narad Muni, they were so exalted, even for their own self-protection, they were so dependent on Krishna. That means if we become genuinely Krishna conscious, we will know that even for my protection, the Lord will take care. I should not be so much worried about my protection also. So, when we see this, it is very important that we have a balanced understanding. It's not that we allow others to play around in our life. At the same time, it's not that we become so enamored by whatever others say and so much agitated and always be in the revengeful mentality. No, we should not be in that mood. So remember, whatever we keep in our heart, that is going to occupy our mental space. So if we keep a grudge against others, that's going to occupy our mental space, and that much space to remember Krishna is reduced. So therefore, it's very important we don't house such kind of negative feelings in our heart. Another interesting instruction mentioned in the scriptures, how to develop this humility. So now we saw that humility is very important. Now how to develop this humility? Let's try to see some instructions. Next slide. So it is said, Vidya Dadati Vinayam. So we'll focus only on the first thing. Vidya Dadati Vinayam. Vinayam means humility, not being anxious to get respect from others. So how do we get this Vinayam? Vidya Dadati. The real knowledge, real education can give us this humility. If we have become puffed up, then whatever we are thinking is Vidya, whatever we have learned, actually it is not Vidya. If that Vidya is not giving us Vinayam, it is not Vidya, it is Avidya. It is ignorance that we are pursuing in the name of knowledge. So, when we develop real knowledge, the consequence of real knowledge is Vinayam. Another place it is also told in the scripture that real knowledge means that which liberates us. Ya sa vidya ya vimohayati. So that knowledge is that which actually liberates us from lower feelings, right? That means the sign of real, when we cultivate real knowledge, we will have genuine humility. And the next line says, Vinayad yati patratam. By Vinaya, by humility, we acquire a qualification called patratam. Patratam means having the qualification to receive, to be able to receive something special. Patratam. And then next line says, patratam dhanam apnoti. Patratvat dhanam apnoti. By getting that qualification called patratam, we get dhanam, we get wealth. That means whatever is required for our livelihood, we get that. And by dhanam, dhana dharma tatas sukham. By dhana, we can practice dharma, and by that we get sukham, real happiness. That means vinayam is actually a very important quality, humility. If we want to be sukham, we want to be happy, then we have to develop this humility. And how to develop this humility? By acquiring real knowledge, vidya. Next slide. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, what are the symptoms of a person who is actually humble? Vidya Vinaya Sampanni. Again, the same two words are used here, vidya and vinaya. Vidya Vinaya Sampanne Brahmane Gavi Hastini Shuni Jaiva Swapakecha Pandita Samadarshinaha. This is in the 5th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. So the meaning is, the humble sage, by virtue of true knowledge, sees with equal vision a learned and gentle Brahmana, a cow, an elephant, a dog, and a dog eater. That means when you develop real vidya, spiritual knowledge, that gives you humility, because of which you will be able to see everything around you from a spiritual perspective. You will see everyone equally, samadarshinaha. But when we do not have real vidya, then we will not have humility. Then we will start discriminating. We will see, oh, this person is very rich, that person is not so good. So we only see the material differences. But if we want to samadarshinaha, if we want to be treat everybody equally, then developing this humility by virtue of true knowledge is very, very important. Next slide. So this is what Srila Prabhupada says in one of the purports in Bhagavatam, a very important thing, in fact. One should not be puffed up by borrowed plumes. All energies and powers are derived from the Supreme Source, Lord Krishna, and they act as long as he desires and cease to function as soon as he withdraws. We should know this, very important. We may have some talents and abilities, but we should know all of these talents and abilities that we have got are actually given by Lord Krishna, the Supreme Source. So he has given us, and he can take away from us anytime. So why should we be proud about those things? They are all borrowed plumes, right? They are all borrowed feathers. So we should not be puffed up, proud about it. Prabhupada continues, all electrical energies are received from the powerhouse, and as soon as the powerhouse stops supplying energy, the bulbs are of no use. In a moment's time, such energies can be generated or withdrawn by the supreme will of the Lord. Material civilization without the blessing of the Lord is child's play only. As long as the parents allow the child to play, it is all right. As soon as the parents withdraw, the child has to stop. Now you can see how this is very much relevant today because of the, you know, corona situation. So we may think that we have made a lot of advancement in science and technology, but still we are not able to so quickly come up with a vaccine for this disease, isn't it? That means, just like Prabhupada is saying, material civilization without the blessing of the Lord is child's play only. As long as the parents allow the child to play, it is all right. But as soon as the parents withdraw, the child has to stop playing. The child cannot say that, no, I want to play for some more time. No. Parents will say, come back. It's enough. Today, enough playing. So all our abilities and our different advancements that we have made, it is like a child's play. And as long as we have the blessings of the Lord, we continue to have those powers and abilities. And the moment the Lord doesn't want us to have it, He can take it up. He can take it away. So the point is, we should not be proud of what we have. Be humble, stay grounded, knowing that everything that I have actually belongs to Krishna. This genuine spiritual knowledge can give us real humility. Let's go to the next slide. I think the last slide. So, yes, to conclude, we can say that by cultivating genuine spiritual knowledge, naturally we can become humble. It keeps us grounded. Like we see, many scientists also have said this, that Kelvin, one of the scientists, he says that, if you think strongly enough, you know, science will make you realize about God. That means where the science ends, there the spiritual knowledge begins. I mean, realization of God begins. So it's very important that we develop this great quality of humility, and Lord Krishna has given the first place for this quality, humility, among the 20 items of knowledge that he lists in the 13th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. So this was some understanding about humility. Now we will take up some questions. Anyone has questions, you can unmute yourself and ask your question. And we will try to clarify about, discuss about it. Any question pertaining to what we discussed?
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. Aditya. Yes, sorry. Aditya.
Prabhu, thank you very much for the very insightful discussion. I have a question regarding this Trinada that we should reach, you know. And it says humility, because humility is a state of mind, and one should try and humble state of mind. Now, for that humble state of mind, just for the purpose of chanting, how can we instantly cultivate that?
Nice question. Yes, just for the purpose of chanting, instantly we cannot invoke any quality like that. So when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Trinadapi sunichena taroriva sahishtuna amanina manadena kirtaniya sadahari, he says that if you have this humility and you do not expect respect from others, and you are ready to give respect to everybody in all circumstances, that makes you a candidate, fit candidate to constantly chant the holy names of the Lord. That is what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said. So if you have humility, right, if you are truly humble, even Jesus Christ says this in the Bible. He says the kingdom of God is for the humble and meek. So if you are humble and meek, then God's kingdom is open to you always. Your doors are open. So humility, if you cultivate, then you will be able to constantly remember Krishna and chant his holy names. That is what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says. It is not possible for us to instantly invoke some quality which is actually not there in us. It is not possible. We may make a show of it in front of others for some time, but we cannot always have it like that. So it is very important that we genuinely become humble. And genuine humility we can develop by cultivating spiritual knowledge, vidya. As we said, vidya dadati vinayam. Any other question anyone has got?
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Santosh.
Yes, Prabhu. So when you say vidya dadati vinayam, so again, the sort of jnana approach comes here. So from understanding, from this knowledge about spiritual knowledge of vinaya comes, again it's sort of contaminated, it seems. Is it so, Prabhu?
No, real real knowledge frees you from all contamination. It is not a, as you are saying, it is not a mental approach. Sometimes we think, how to cultivate knowledge? Oh, you simply study the scripture and try to, you know, mug up whatever is there or try to know the knowledge like that. It's not a mental process. This knowledge has to, we have to get realization of this knowledge. And this realization we get by the mercy of Guru and Krishna. So it is not an intellectual process. It has to be realization, realized knowledge. Okay, in the beginning it may look like an intellectual process of just studying the scripture, but it doesn't end by simply studying the scripture. You have to assimilate it by applying it in your daily life with proper guidance. Then you get realization, and that realization keeps you grounded always. It keeps you grounded, right? So cultivating knowledge, in the beginning it may look like a theoretical, but it is actually practical realization. Jnana vijnana sahitam, right? I hope it answers what I said.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. Who is this?
Rohan, Prabhu.
Rohan, yes. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Prabhu, my doubt is we saw in Amrish Maharaj, case was of humility and other he was pride. That Muni was pride.
Proud, yeah.
So can we take the same understanding from Lord Shivas and Daksha and Lord Indra? Yeah, and because we see that Daksha was cursed by again. So was Lord Shiva humble or how, Prabhu? How we should take that? In Indra's case also, Indra was cursed. So can we relate that to Amrish Maharaj's instance?
Okay. Now in Indra's case, Indra was not humble. That's why he was cursed. Now the sage cursed Indra because the sage thought that he's in such a respectable position and he is not humble. Then he is not fit to enjoy all this royal opulences. He has to learn a lesson. That's why he cursed him, that he will lose all his opulence. So Indra was not humble. He was definitely proud in that instance when we see. But in the case of Lord Shiva, Lord Shiva is a self-realized soul and he's a universal head actually. He's in that state. So Daksha Prajapati, expecting Lord Shiva to stand up and give him respect, showed how Daksha Prajapati was so hungry for respect. He was not humble. So Lord Shiva is a yogi. He is self-situated. He is not at all worried about these external formalities and all that. He was humble, but it was Daksha Prajapati who was not humble. And so I think that we have come to the end of the session. So thank you very much for participating. So we will have this discussion Every Tuesday, we will be discussing one quality out of the 20 items of knowledge from the 13th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Thank you very much for attending today's session. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhu. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much,
Prabhu. Hare Krishna.